On behalf of Fred Ross's family, I want to welcome all of you here to this celebration of a truly amazing life. My name is Jerry Cohen, and I want to express my gratitude to the family for asking me to participate in this program. While we're here to honor Fred, I think each of us that's here participating today know that it's an honor to be here. You'll notice in your programs that the words to Joe Hill are printed out. And after Cesar gives the eulogy, we're all going to sing Joe Hill. And then Fred Ross Jr., with the help of his nephew Brandon and his niece Heather, will conduct a community eulogy so that those of you who wish to share your fondest remembrances of Fred are invited to do so at that time. And I think, in addition to Cesar's comments, that's an appropriate way to remember the life of a man who touched so many lives. As we all know, Fred fought more fights and discovered, trained, taught, and worked with more organizers and planted more seeds of righteous indignation against injustice than any man we're likely ever to meet again. What we can do in a few hours today is only touch on a few of the important stories that people have to tell about how Fred touched them. Before we do that, I just want to briefly touch on the way Fred used language. His language was as spare and as lean as he was. He always got right to the point. And I'll give you an example. For those of you that have never seen it, this is a little book. As you notice, it fits in your pocket. It's designed to be used, like everything else Fred did. It was put out by Neighbor to Neighbor in 1989. And this is for my fellow lawyers in the crowd. On page 59, Fred has a subject called Fast Talkers. What he has to say about it isn't very long, but it is to the point. It says, look out for the fast talkers. That may apply to some of the politicians in the crowd as well. I don't know. The other brief axiom that I'd like to cite right now is on page 55 of this useful book, and it's a great definition of an organizer. And I think it's also printed on the back of your program. Fred wrote, a good organizer is a social arsonist who goes around setting people on fire. And finally, I'd like to just allude to one interview that Fred gave in 1982. He rarely gave interviews. The purpose of that was he wanted to thrust other people forward and push them. So he deliberately stayed in the background. In this particular interview, the interviewer asked him, Fred, have you ever had a regular job? Have you ever had a regular job? And Fred's response was, a real job, you mean? No, I never had a real job. I've been lucky. And I think that those of us whose lives have been touched by Fred have been lucky too, because most of us have never had real jobs either. And for that, I know I personally want to thank Fred. Just one personal image I have of him. The other day, on Sunday night, as a matter of fact, Jim Herman and Fred Ross Jr. and Bill Carter and I came to check out this hall just to see what it was like. And that night I had a dream that Fred was standing right outside these doors. And he was about 12 feet tall, and there were branches and twigs and leaves growing out of him. I mean, he was just springing with life. And I like that image of Fred because if you look around this room, you'll see all the organizers and all the extraordinary talent that he trained. Today's celebration isn't simply about the past. It's about the work that's going on today and the fights that'll be fought in the future. And I think when you look at the extraordinary group of talented people that have come together here, it shows that even in his death, Fred is a great organizer. To deliver the invocation are two men who have spent their whole lives helping others. Story is Ann Saito Howden.
Am I going to break this? Mr. Cohen and friends, in remembering Fred Ross today, I want to take you back 50 years to the days following bombing of Pearl Harbor, when Japanese Americans on the Pacific coast were cruelly removed by the federal government to hastily built relocation centers west of the east of the Sierra Nevada in remote areas, remote isolated areas of the country. The summary evacuation allowed too little time for people to, or in an orderly manner, to dispose of their property and to take care of the sources of sustenance for them, their farms, their nurseries, their grocery stores, and all manner of little shops that the Japanese had operated. There was innumerable forced losses for the Japanese American and Americans, and the inner hurt was incalculable and has persisted for all this time. Not long after we were shipped off into these camps, the labor shortage persisting in the United States prompted the federal government to see if they could relocate some of the residents of the centers to jobs in the Midwest and the East. My then husband, Mitch Kunitani, and I were sent to Cleveland, Ohio, where we first met Fred, and Fred became a memorable part of our life. I first became a member of Fred Ross's staff, then Mitch, who was employed by a religious organization in the resettlement process, also worked very closely with Fred. Our situation was fraught with uncertainty and anxiety. We wondered how the people of Cleveland would react to us. Here we were, strangers, looking very much like the enemy their sons were fighting, and even our federal government were treating us as though we were enemy aliens. In this uneasy scene, Fred soon became a source of great strength and reassurance for us. In appearance and manner, this tall, good-looking man was somewhere between Henry Fonda and Clint Eastwood in their time. But his laconic Western manner was just a veneer, and it covered a passionate sense of justice, a determined and focused energy, and matchless perseverance. Our fellow relocatees, both young and old, arrived daily in Cleveland in an economy that was based on steel to find jobs in a milieu that was very different from the agricultural, laid-back, life of the West Coast. Our neighbors and co-workers now had names like Krusinich, Krajewski, or Hummel, not Togasaki, Wong, or Martinez. It was Fred's job then to try to find employment for all of us, and housing too, and facilitate the entry of Japanese Americans into the life of Cleveland with minimum trauma. Pressed into action was the whole range of skills and abilities that Fred had. He was job finder, advocate, teacher, counselor, PR man for the office, and conflict resolver. Talents not usually required of the average bureaucrat. And of course, Fred delivered with vast resourcefulness and total commitment of himself and his time. To all of us, this was a great help in a deeply troubled time. At the personal level, Mitch and I were fortunate to have many good times with Fred and his lively, sensitive wife, Frances. We shared strong views on anti-fascism, civil liberties, and the need for empowerment of Japanese Americans and other minority groups. And Fred and Frances provided a warm haven of good fellowship, good talk, hope, and laughter. Most important, laughter. When the government began in early 1945 to allow the evacuees to return to the West Coast, Fred was assigned to the resettlement office in San Francisco. His duties were very much the same as those in Cleveland, but this time he was functioning in an environmental situation of much greater hostility. There were opposition to the employment of Japanese American in jobs, even in public jobs. And there were housing problems, of course. And even some of the unions were most uncooperative and unhelpful. So Fred's skills as mediator, as persuader, were called into use all the time. I'm indebted, incidentally, for the help of Kay Patterson, Kay Ueda Patterson, who is here. Kay, would you stand up, please? Kay was with Fred from the very beginning in the Cleveland, Ohio office, and she came with him to San Francisco and stayed in the resettlement office there until almost the end of Fred's tenure. And she has helped me to relive this difficult period of our lives. Now, others have spoken and will speak about the distinguished work that Fred has done in civil rights, in labor, and community organization, which consumed the energies and devotion for the rest of his life. I want to say one last farewell to dear, dear Fred, who gave us so much at a time when we needed so much help. And I look back over our friendship with great love, gratitude, and yes, reverence.
Thank you, Ann.
In 1947, working with Saul Alinsky, Fred Ross helped to form the Community Service Organization. And we're lucky today to have one of the co-founders of the CSO and the current state president, Tony Rios, to tell us about his work with Fred Ross.
I saw Fred Ross about 3 weeks ago. My daughter and I, she knew him when she was a little girl, and she's here with me again, Santa Luz Rios. He died or passed away perhaps about more than a dozen hours after I saw him. I was probably still in the airport when he died. Ever since then, that's 3 weeks ago, I've been reviewing many of the things that happen in our lives, especially in those cases where we were able to work together. I reached a conclusion in the last 3 weeks, and it was confirmed here today, that we were different in some ways and very much alike in other ways. I always claimed to be an organizer, and I still do. Just like Fred Ross. But today I have to concede one thing. I was a type of organizer that learned from the Irish Wobblies that hate the boss technique, and also was guided and have been guided by Barrio Law, el que la hace, la paga. Who does it, pays for it. However, today, as I see all of us here, the technique that Fred Ross used was far superior to my ways as an organizer. Again today, he brought us together because of his love and his ways that cut deep into our lives and left a lot of memories together. One never knows who you run into on an everyday basis. As you walk out the building, you're liable to walk somebody that would be the greatest friend, the greatest hero that you ever met. Somebody told Fred Ross, 1947, after the rival defeat for the city council, that someone was going to visit me. When Fred Ross walked into the living room, the first thing I saw was a pair of boots. And I figured, well, what is this redneck doing in my house? He said hello, sat down very quietly, and my wife and my two girls at that time came out, and he got to know the family. In a few minutes, I completely forgot that he was someone, a stranger, that came in to butt into our lives in the committee that eventually developed the Community Service Organization. And as we talked, we reviewed a number of things. He got to know me, got to know my attitudes, and I think he understood me better than I did his attitudes and his ways of treating people. Well, that was the introduction, and I'll never forget it. He and I made good friends, and I began to trust him more and more every day. He left a lot of things for me, a lot of goodwill in many barrios throughout the state of California, Riverside, in the Citrus Belt, where I had to work again many years after that. That was really a gift, because he left many friends, and he told many of his friends that I was his one of his best friends. So they treated me just about the same as they did his. One time I started a campaign for Judge Sound, the first Hindu to become an American citizen in the United States, and he ran for Congress in the Imperial Valley, Riverside area. And when I took the job from the Hindu committee to work the Riverside area, I ran into friends of Fred Ross, anywhere from San Bernardino, especially Casablanca and Corona and all the communities around there. Before you know it, they set up an office for me and a part-time secretary, even before I got there, before I started to work. So with Fred, wherever he went, he did a job. Many times people say you can't beat Fred because he's a very stubborn man. And that was true to this day. He never gave up a fight or a task until he finished it. That is the kind of stubborn person that can get things accomplished. I remember 1947 when Ed Roybal ran for the city council. He lost. He came at a poor third with 3,400 votes. That was again Parley Parker Christensen, who at one time ran for president in the Socialist Party ticket. He had been there for about 40 years. Fred Ross came after that defeat and started with us recruiting registrars. I have a photo that we took during the first class of the registrars that he recruited. 49 of us are in that photo. According to Beatrice Griffith, she claims in her book, referring to Fred Ross and CSO and Ed Roybal's election, we had 63 registrars. At that time, the city council races were every 2 years. As I told you, Roybal got 3,400 votes. 2 years later, in the finals, Roybal got 20,581 votes. Parley Parker Christensen, part of the establishment, got 12,015 votes. That is the difference between not one election and the other. The difference was Fred Ross. You hear a lot of other stories about other people that supported Ed Roybal and brought him to this victory. But you can see the proof that we have documented for many, many years. The latest voter registration drive that Fred Ross helped us, it was not under the Sol Alinsky or the Industrial Heroes Foundation payroll. It was on our own payroll in CSO. He registered in the general vicinity of Boyle Heights between the downtown area and Atlantic Boulevard in an unincorporated area. He registered 16,000 votes. The last 11 days of that drive, we were registering over 1,000 every day. So when we tell this story in the South, people don't argue with us anymore. They know who made the difference, and that was Fred Rawls. And we had several police cases, the Bloody Christmas case and the Ulloa Rios case. It hadn't been for Fred Rawls that hardly slept during those days. We wouldn't have won those cases in the courts because we had already lost many, either the district attorney, city attorney, or the biased judges or whoever, always screwed up our cases. But because of Fred Ross' untiring devotion to justice, he made it possible for us to uncover everything that we could in order to win that case. I probably would have gone to jail a whole year if I had been convicted, because in every case, the Bloody Christmas boys were accused of violating the law, and I was accused of violating the law. So first we had to run that thing about whether or not we were bad guys or not. Well, I can say one thing, that it hadn't been Fred Ross around, we wouldn't have won either one of the cases. As it was a great victory for us, and we kept winning all of 11 cases, a total of 11 cases up and down the state of California. I'm talking about the power structure, fighting the power structure. If it had been me, I probably would have taken my jacket off and swung as many fists as I could. And I probably would have lost the case. So I learned a lot from Fred Ross. I haven't forgotten my techniques, but I know since we got all of us here today, he is still very much alive as far as I'm concerned. He helped us for 8 years, a campaign that took 8 years to win the pension for non-citizen drive. That was a case where the legislators just looked at us like nothing. Well, when they start hearing about the voter registration drives and all the other things that we were doing, they begin to listen. We got the pension for non-citizens, for those that lived in this country for 25 years or more, and a lot of them had been here 40 or 50 years, most of them were.
Thank you, Tony. When Jessica Govea met Fred Ross, I think she was about 7. And I think that meeting changed her life and the life of her family. It's a real pleasure to introduce Jessica because she's a special friend. She's going to talk about Fred, and then she's going to sing one of Fred's favorite songs.
To thank Fred's family for allowing me the privilege of sharing with you a couple of some very wonderful memories that I have of Fred. The first thing I'd like to share with you is a little story. In the summer of 1959, I was 12 years old and had been under the influence of Fred Ross and CSO for 4 years. At that time, the park and playground that was nearest our home was about 3 miles away. And to get there, you had to walk down a very heavily traveled county road. One hot Bakersfield Sunday, my best friend, Virginia Sanchez, took her little brothers and sisters to that park. And on her way home, she was killed by a fast-moving car. I was grief-stricken. had seen Fred teach people how to turn grief and anger into action. And so I gathered Virginia's and my friends, and we talked, and we decided to do a petition campaign demanding a park within safe walking distance and demanding that a park be put in our neighborhood. Our goal was to get the signatures of every adult in our neighborhood. And so this little bunch of 11 and 12-year-olds set out to apply Fred's teachings. We told our story. We kept track of our progress. We went back to the not homes. And we badgered the one cranky holdout until he signed the petition. And so we were able to turn in a unanimous petition. And 6 years later, we got our park. The second thing I'd like to share with you is a letter that I wrote to Fred on the 22nd of September. Dear Fred, I have a very fond and clear recollection of the first time that I met you. It was the summer of 1956. You were the CSO organizer, a tall man who wore plaid shirts and khaki pants. My mother was a shy Chicana farm worker and homemaker who was raising three young children. My father was a Mexican immigrant working at Santa Fe Railroad. We were living in a tiny one-bedroom house at 1510 Padre Street in the Little Oki in Bakersfield, and I was a 9-year-old about to enter the fifth grade. You honored us by having dinner with us that night, and it was such a special event for us that my mom still remembers what she cooked. That was the beginning of a wonderful ribbon of childhood memories that revolve around you and CSO work. Work that you, as the organizer, helped to shape and that profoundly affected the direction of my family's life. Memories that included you working with my mom, with Esther Martinez, with Ernestine Salazar, and the other CSO ladies, and teaching them to be aggressive service center advocates. My dad teaching you Mexican dichos. The jam-packed monthly CSO membership meetings that the whole family attended, where my parents and people like them did their business in a respectful and effective way. Going door to door with my dad doing CSO work. Meetings in our living room where my mom and dad were Henry and Esther Martinez, Gilbert and Ernestine Salazar, the Burciagas, the Nunez, and other leaders of the chapter struggled with important issues and made good and tough decisions for action, and fights with the local powers that CSO won. Being a CSO kid helped me to grow up with hope and with a belief in myself and my worth that has led me to what is now nearly 27 years of organizing work. Fred, you are the purest organizer I have ever known. I hope that I can thank you for what you have taught me over these many years by passing some of it on to others. You are loved, admired, and respected in the Govea home, and have been since that day in 1956 when you first came to our door. Thank you. Con mucho cariño, Jessica Govea.
Dicen que por las noches no más se le ven puro llorar. Dicen que no comía, no más se le ven puro tomar. Juran que el mismo cielo se estremecía al oír su llanto. Cómo sufrió por ella, que hasta en su muerte la fue llamando. Ay, 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 ay. Cantaba. Ay, 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 ay.
That was wonderful, Jessica. In Delano in the late 60s, the place to be on a Friday night was Filipino Hall. For those of us in this room. And for most of us in this room, the highlight of the meetings, those Friday night meetings, were the actos and the music of El Teatro Campesino. And it's really a thrill to introduce Luis Valdez and Danny Valdez and the Teatro Campesino.
A couple of words.
Our involvement with Fred Ross was deep, it was profound, because we met in the trenches. I met Fred Ross in 1965 in Delano and discovered one of my teachers. This has been the century of the common man, and it has taken uncommon people to bring that about. When Fred was born in 1910, it was a very different United States of America, with perhaps different gatherings and groups in the barrios and in the ghettos. And it took a whole generation of human beings, giants like Fred Ross, who put their skins and their bodies and their bones on the line for the sake of a common principle, human equality. And in this century, we have seen the rebirth of another America, where the minorities, the women, the disenfranchised speak out and have been encouraged and organized to do so by men like Fred Ross. This was a century that exposed the ugly American, Fred Ross, to the total contrary point, was the beautiful American. He was the human American. He was the American who came out to the barrios, who came out to the labor camps, and put himself on the line together with the people that he was trying to organize. In the DiGiorgio campaign, early in the grape strike, I met Fred Ross, the teacher, and he taught us some very basic principles about getting people together. One was the nature of direct human contact, and he did this by contacting us directly, the people that he was organizing. He was disciplined. I'd never met an organizer as disciplined as Fred Ross. He was there every day and every night, as long as it took, pushing for follow-through. And he taught us to follow through. Back yourself up. Don't take your victory for granted. Don't get cocky. Do the work, and do it with humor and human sensitivity. In the DiGiorgio campaign, we got involved with a thing called the Daily Leaflet, El Mosquito Zumbador. I don't know if you remember that. The zooming mosquito. It was a leaflet, the noon leaflet that we would take out to the workers. There always had to be some joke or some dicho, often provided by Fred himself, to grab the workers' attention so that the organizers could talk to them. And this humor, this joke, this cartoon became deadly serious business in the hands of Fred Ross. And he was a man who knew, a human being who knew how to contact people directly, because he was a common man, an uncommon common man. And his heart touched everyone that he ever met. More recently, a couple of years ago, we began to talk about a film based on his book, Conquering Goliath, which chronicles the early days of Cesar Chavez's career in Oxnard. Again, the same enthusiasm, the same desire for follow-through. I described to him how difficult it is to get politically oriented films made in Hollywood. He reminded me that nothing has ever been easy, and that we must continue to scale the gates of injustice in order to get the word out. I love that book that he wrote on Cesar, because it seems to me it not only captures Cesar, it also captures Fred Ross. The clarity of his vision, the purity of his heart, the power of his honesty and his conscience. To his spirit, his living spirit, we dedicate these songs from the DiGiorgio campaign. Orale, welcome here.
Ha llegado la noticia muy alegre que Deleno es diferente. Pues el pueblo ahí está en contra de los rancheros y engreídos que acababan con la gente. hermanos, la alegría compartimos con todos los campesinos. ¡Viva la revolución!
Shut up.
because in the first manuscript, there's a whole section devoted to Dolores, and it's entitled Woman in Motion. Yeah. And after trying to get a hold of Dolores all this week, I think it still applies. Fred also used to call Dolores La Passionada de la Huelga. It's really nice to be able to introduce one of the co-founders of the United Farm Workers Union and a vice president of the United Farm Workers Union, Dolores Huerta.
I feel very honored to be at this podium because I know there are so many of us out there that should also be here telling their stories of what Fred, how he transformed our lives. I especially want to thank Fred Jr., Julie, and Rob. I want to thank you for sharing your father with all of us. I always call Fred my spiritual father because he really was. When I first met Fred, I was a single parent with a couple of children. And the great thing about Fred was his incredible persistence. You know, once in our first house meeting, where he showed us the pictures of what poor people could do as they had done down in the LACSO to fight the police, to bring in health clinics, to get people elected to office. And he showed us these pictures of these hundreds of people, like we are here today, in one room, in one meeting. I had never seen that many people in a meeting before, and I thought, this man is a miracle maker. And I decided to follow Fred in organizing. We were registering voters one day in front of the Heinz Cannery in Tracy, California. And you know, one of the first things that Fred, as you all know, taught us to do was to get out there and register voters. I mean, my first job was I was a door knocker. He convinced me I could also register voters, too. And we were out there registering voters, and by that time, a lot of people had flaked out on Fred and hadn't shown up, so it was just he and I was supposed to report to my orientation as a teacher. I was teaching school then, and I could not bear to leave this man alone registering those voters, so that was the end of my teaching career. It was probably one of the best decisions that I ever made in my life, but that's the way that Fred was. He was so persistent, he would not let you go. When I first signed up to be a door knocker, I was only supposed to go on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Well, pretty soon he was calling me on Mondays and Wednesdays, and pretty soon it was Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And I knew that, you know, I had to give everything up and just help Fred out, because this man presented so much dignity. He taught with his life. He taught with his life. I have to say that the things I remember of Fred, when he first organized us in Stockton, he came in, we had the house meetings, many house meetings, we had our big general meeting, we elected our officers, you know, right away he put everybody up at the front of the table there, and he sat back. And he let us, we were then supposed to run this organization, of course we were all scared to death. And then he left. And we didn't see him again for 6 months. And we had to remember, what did Fred say? What would he do? We were fighting the police, we were fighting the Board of Supervisors, we were fighting the County Welfare Department, fighting everybody, fighting the redevelopment agencies. What would Fred do? What would he have said? You know, we treasured his every word, and that's the way he was. Whatever he said, he measured it so that he knew that his words had an impact. And we would try to remember what Fred told us so that we would then be able to do what we had to do to fight those injustices. And this was a totally volunteer organization. People forget that sometimes. CSO was totally volunteer. The only paid staff were Fred and Cesar for the whole state at that time. And one of the things, of course, that I wish everybody would learn this, but Fred taught us that politicians are our servants. So if some of the politicians out there wonder why all of us are so irreverent, you can thank Fred Ross for that. He said, you know, he told us, you pay, the people pay the taxes, the bureaucrats and the politicians work for you. And this was such an important lesson because it taught all of us, you know, it gave us that strength that we need. Fred's faith in people, I think, is unmatchable. He knew that if people got together and organized, that they could solve their problems. I mean, this has got to be the ultimate of empowerment. Fred never took any power for himself. He always gave it away. He always gave it away. He gave it to other people. He showed them how to use the power that they had of numbers. He taught them, he taught us how to use organization to solve our problems in a democratic way. It seems like such a simple lesson, but all of us who have been organizers know how difficult it really is. It was mentioned the kind of discipline that Fred had and the way that he made us look into ourselves. I remember many times when I would say something and Fred would say, well, why did you say that? And I think, oh my goodness, why did I say that? You know, I'd have to start thinking about, why did I say that? What does it mean? How does it impact on people? But he made us look into ourselves, and so it was a constant growing, a constant growth. He always made us get into situations where we had to grow. You know, when we went out on that first trip to New York City, here we had a group of farm workers that went in a yellow bus all the way to New York City. And I wish you could have seen these farm workers who were going to organize the whole great boycott. Most of them couldn't read or write. Many couldn't speak English. Many of them were very elderly, some of the elderly Filipino brothers that went with us. And of course, we had a few young organizers that went out there. But when we had our meetings, everybody had a role. Everybody had dignity with Fred Ross. Everybody gave a report about what they were doing. No one was ever put aside. There were no lesser people around Fred Ross. Everybody had equal dignity. And I guess we heard earlier about the kind of a man that Fred Ross is, because he will be with us forever. But I also want to say one other thing about Fred Ross. He was also a feminist. Fred Ross was a feminist because Fred Ross believed that women were equal. And he made a place for women at the executive board tables in CSO, a place for women as organizers, a place for women as boycotters. He trained women how to be organizers out there in the field. Fred didn't think that women had to take a backward step. And all of us that were lucky enough to work with Fred knew that he was the ultimate gentleman, that you never had to worry about Fred ever, ever getting out of line or even saying anything that might make anyone uncomfortable. That's the kind of a human being that he was. I also had a dream about Fred. I was lucky enough to see him, thanks to Fred Jr., before he passed on, and he looked absolutely beautiful. You know, his skin was glowing, his face was beautiful. He looked totally, totally beautiful and spiritual as the kind of person that he was. And my dream about Fred was similar. I dreamt, this is the night before he died, that he was about 12 feet tall, and that he was speaking, and I was walking with him, and we were at La Paz, walking amongst the oak trees at La Paz. And I said, gee, Fred, you are so tall. And he smiled, and he spoke. And as he spoke, his voice was booming, and he could hear it, and it carried on and on. And I said, boy, Fred, your voice is so wonderful and so strong that everybody can hear it. And of course, I think all of us will carry Fred's voice forward. I used to tell Fred all the time that, as we all know, he was not a religious person in that sense, that we were going to canonize him whether he liked it or not. And thanks to Father Bill O'Donnell, we might be able to. But Fred's simple faith in people made him a miracle worker. He taught all of us how to be miracle workers. And you know, Fred always said, if you're not working for social change, you're not doing anything with your life. You know, if you're frittering around your life, being materialistic, or just having a good time, you're not doing anything with your life. He placed a very, I won't say, I think, a very good charge on us to put to do with our lives. And if you weren't doing something for people, Fred Ross had no time for you. He had no time. He wanted to be only with those people that were working for social change and willing to make that sacrifice as he did, which I think made it easier for us to make some sacrifices to get the job done. Fred Ross will continue to make miracles through us. And I know that he will be, and he will continue to be, our saint and our spiritual father. Thank you.
The next organizer that'll speak has a unique experience.
I too want to thank the Ross family. In the novel Beloved by Toni Morrison, there is a line that gets repeated often about being given the occasion to lay down our sword and shield and to be back together, to come back to the family. So I thank you for bringing us all together today. It is a uniquely, to me, humbling experience to be here. In this crowd of witnesses and cloud of saints, I bring to the Ross family the warm feelings of the Industrial Areas Foundation, the cabinet, and the organizers in the 14 states where the IAF is presently organizing. When I was 24, I met Fred. And I was thinking last night that when I met him, he was the age I am now. So there's about 28, 30 years have passed. And many times I say, I think this is enough. I think we should hang this up. And then I remember something that Fred said. He said, John L. Lewis started organizing the CIO when he was 58. So, damn it, Fred. Fred's roots were not in the Industrial Areas Foundation. Saul David Alinsky grew the IAF in soil that had already been tilled by Fred. In many ways, the vision of Fred Ross preceded that of Saul Alinsky. Now, we have Saul David Alinsky's writings to remind us over and over again what some of those universals of organizing are. And I can't wait to see the writings of Fred Ross Sr. And then I think we have a very full picture regarding the universals of organizing. Some of those universals of organizing are very much alive in the work that all of you are doing, certainly in the work that Fred Jr. and Neighbor to Neighbor is doing, and very much alive in the Industrial Areas Foundation today. I was thinking what some of those universals were, and I got up to about 12, and I said, I can't give them all 12 because they're going to, well, we all have, as we age, we don't have the same kidneys we used to have, so we can't sit here forever. So I tried to boil it down to three, and then I was looking for a paradigm that would describe those three. And the paradigm is in the Old Testament. But when I got to the motel last night, I realized I didn't have my Bible with me, but there was a Gideon's Bible in the motel. And I thought that probably somebody could use the rest of it, but I would take this much. and I asked my bishop, Chris Hartmar, if he would forgive me for this. But if you'll bear with me for 1 minute, I want to read you a story about the work of a great organizer, Moses. You remember, Moses had got the people out in the wilderness, and he had to walk them around for 40 years so they would forget that they were out there looking for milk and honey. And after he kind of wore out that first generation, then he could build a nation. And the people wanted to go back, and they began to murmur. And they said, if only we could have some meat. In Egypt, when we were slaves, we used to eat all the flesh we wanted, and it cost us nothing. Remember the cucumbers and the watermelons and the leeks and the onions and the garlic we had. But now our strength is gone. There's nothing all day to eat but this manna. And Moses heard all the people complaining as they stood around in groups at the entrances of their tents. He was distressed because the Lord had become angry with them. And he said to the Lord, why have you treated me so badly, and why are you displeased with me? Have you given me the responsibility for all these people? I didn't create them. I didn't bring them to birth. Why should I have to carry them in my arms like babies all the way to the land you promised to their ancestors? Where could I get enough meat for all these people? And they kept whining and murmuring. And they kept asking for meat. I can't be responsible for all these people by myself. It's too much for me. If you're going to treat me like this, then have pity on me and kill me right here. I hope I brought the right pages here. And the Lord said to Moses, this is the important part, assemble 70 respected leaders who are recognized as leaders of the people and bring them to me in the tent of the presence and tell them to stand there beside you. And I will come down and speak with you there, and I will give some of the spirit I have given to you to them. Then they can help you bear the responsibility for these people, and you will not have to bear it alone. So Moses went out and told the people what the Lord had said, and he assembled the 70 and placed them around the tent. And the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him, and he took some of the spirit he had given to Moses and gave it to the 70 leaders. And when the spirit came on them, they began to shout like prophets. And suddenly the Lord sent a wind that brought quails from the sea flying 3 feet above the ground, and they settled on the camp all around for miles and miles in every direction. So all that day and all that night and all the next day, the people worked catching quails, and they spread them out to dry around the camp. Now, I was there, and I want to demythologize this. When Moses went out into the desert to talk to God, he really didn't go to talk to God. He went to talk to Fred. And Fred said, Moses, I have explained this to you time after time. Call a house meeting. And so the universal is wrapped up in that one lesson. I would just like to point to three universals for all of us who organize and those of us who struggle. First, that one leader, even charismatic Moses, can't bag enough birds for the whole multitude. That collective leadership saves us, and that is the lesson of Fred Ross Sr. Two, that the power of the collective is possible only when ordinary leaders, let's say neighbors, are back in respectful relationship. And in a time of language such as ethnic cleansing, don't we need to be back into respectful relationship? And finally, there is the iron rule, the universal of the iron rule. And I believe this is the most important lesson that Fred taught me and all of us. The iron rule is this. It is the flip side of the golden rule. The golden rule is that if you see someone in trouble, then you should always be there on their side. And if there are oxes in the ditch, you should help them pull it out. You're always your brother or sister's keeper. But the iron rule is, Fred's rule is, you should never, never do for others what they can do for themselves. And that is the power of Fred Ross. He taught us how to do for ourselves. Now I'd like to close what I have to say the way I think Fred would have. I think he would have said something to the effect, I want to thank Mr. Delancey for the use of his house this evening. And I appreciate the fact that Mrs. Delancey and the others work so hard to provide the refreshments. And next week I'll be coming back through here, and I think that there will be time for about 35 or 40 house meetings. So I would like to see those of you who want power and want to change this circumstance to raise your hand, and we'll meet with me after the meeting. I'll get your phone numbers and your addresses, and we'll line up 40 house meetings for next week. Would you raise your hand?
I think you'll be happy to know that it's time for Jessica to sing another one of Fred's favorite songs. Jessica.
I just want to preface this song by saying that in spite of what the words say, la vida de Fred valió muchísimo. Y lo seguirá siendo. And if you know the song and you feel like singing it, come right on in. No vale nada la vida. La vida no vale nada. Comienza siempre llorando y así llorando se acaba. Por eso es que en este mundo la vida no vale nada. Bonito León, Guanajuato, su feria con su jugada. Allí se apuesta la vida y se respeta al que gana. Ay, en mi León, Guanajuato, la vida no vale nada. El Cristo de la montaña, del cerro del cubilete, consuelo de los que sufren, adoración de la gente. El Cristo de la montaña, del cerro del cubilete. No vale nada la vida. Este es para Fred. Yo ya me voy al puerto donde se halla la barca de oro que debe conducirme. Yo ya me voy. Solo vengo a despedirme,
Adiós, mi bien. Adiós para siempre, adiós. No volverán mis ojos a mirarte, ni tus oídos escucharán mi canto. Voy a aumentar los mares con mi llanto. Adiós, mi bien. Adiós para siempre, adiós. No volverán mis ojos a mirarte, ni tus oídos escucharán mi canto. Voy a aumentar los mares con mi llanto. Adiós, mi bien. Adiós para siempre. Adiós.
Thank you, Fred.
For the past few years, neighbor to neighbor has been involved in, and this is a woman who's in political office, who's a straight talker and not a fast talker. She is always there when you need her, and I mean always. It's a real honor to introduce Congresswoman Nancy Pelosi.
Thank you very much, Jerry. Are we on? And also thanks to Fred and to Julie and to Rob for the opportunity to extend my condolences publicly to you, both personally on behalf of my family, my husband Paul, who's here. Don't worry, Paul, I'm not going to start to sing. And officially, in fact, I was told to stop singing during the last and officially on behalf of my colleagues in the Congress of the United States, some of whom knew Fred Ross, and many of whom know Fred Ross, Jr. I had the privilege on Fred Ross, Sr.'s 80th birthday to speak on the floor of the House and tell them about all of his accomplishments. It was really double the statement you would usually make on such an occasion because there were so many accomplishments. And in telling my colleagues about Fred Ross, I was telling them about you and all that you have done working with him. So that was a couple of years ago. So 2 years later, when Fred was sick and we were getting the updates from Fred Jr., I was sharing this with my colleagues, and they said, well, it must be hopefully a source of consolation to the family that Fred lived a long life, that he passed his 80th birthday, and then when he passed away, that obituaries in newspapers all over the country spoke so glowingly of this man and what he had accomplished. And then, since we're getting on down today, I'll tell you what we really did also talk about in the Congress about Fred Ross. We had, as I said, I had bragged and boasted about his accomplishments, and we were taking the reverse. I was saying to my colleagues, how do I comfort Julia and Rob and Fred? Are any words adequate on the loss of your parent? And then we started to talk about the reverse. What do people say at the funerals of Fred Ross's foes? Does anybody go to their funerals? Can you imagine someone getting up at someone that Fred was organizing against and saying, our friend, he held the line against health benefits for farm workers?
And now we're going to brag about how we held the line against those people getting registered. And it goes on and on. If you want to talk about empowerment, registration, working conditions, wages, the list goes on, all the things that Dolores and all of you have worked for. So it was a source of consolation to us, and I hope a source of consolation to the family, that so many, many people are here gathered today, so many proud to be associated with the work of Fred Ross, and also that we know that it would be very hard for them to say any nice thing at the funerals of the people he fought against. Maybe they could say, we decided one thing, they loved their families. And then we said, but Fred did too, and he loved his family so much that he wanted to make the world a better place for his children and for all children. And that's why he was empowering people the way he was and organizing people the way he was. I had the privilege of being touched personally by Fred Ross in my own campaign for Congress. I tell you about it to tell you about what it was like in the room when Fred would be there teaching the young people, some not so young people, how to organize and how to get out a vote. You've all shared the experience. We've heard references to tell your story. I still have them coming up to me and saying, I was in your campaign because I care about the water I drink and the air I breathe, and you know, the list goes on and on about how Fred made them understand why they were involved and taught them skills. And I can recall in a flash, as I'm sure you all can, the glow in the faces of people young and old, but new to Fred as a teacher, and how he empowered them and instructed them. We talked about Fred in the past, but frankly, all of his work is about the future, making it better, having an impact for generations to come. When I would see him in the room with the young people organizing, what was striking was the simplicity, the certainty, the strength of the message that he was delivering to them. What was interesting was to see his empowerment in that room and this room and many, many rooms over the years. That not only talking about how people should determine themselves what their future should be, about self-determination, but also the principle of making that happen. I thought when I saw him have some references to religion here today. One of the encyclicals of the Pope, and I identify it with Fred Ross Sr. in that the Pope put out one where he talked about social action, and he talked about observe, think, act. It was the encyclical about teaching social action, and I think that Fred implemented it very well, as you all are a testimony to. In any case, I hope it is a consolation to the children that this very dignified man physically left this earth with such respect throughout his life, such an acknowledgement throughout his life and at the end of his life of his good works, such sense of accomplishment and achievement that will be carried on for 100 years to come without any hesitation. And I think if I could say about his accomplishments, one that is making our country better and has certainly had an impact and a wholesome impact on our society, is that he empowered people of color. And in doing so, he made each and every one of our lives better. So within this legacy, you've heard it before, and I will bear witness to the fact that in this legacy of empowering people, especially people of color, Fred Ross lives. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is a mischievous devil who just loves a good boycott. In the 60s, he drives to Delano without any need for recognition, and he tried to teach us what a hiring hall was. what it meant to administer a union contract, and he made damn sure that it was very hard to move grapes in and out of this port. Recently, it's been a real pleasure working with him on the boycott of Salvadoran coffee, and he was essential to the success of that boycott, although he doesn't like to admit it. To me, he's the epitome of what it means to be a great labor leader. He not only worked tirelessly for his own union, but he went out and helped other people when they needed to build their union. Jim Herman, President Emeritus of the Longshoremen Union.
It's very difficult to measure up to those kind and generous words. If you divide them, you might somewhere find something more accurate, but I thank you for them. I had the good fortune of encountering Fred Ross at about the time the great farm worker struggle started. And I made a trip to Delano, and I met my old friend Cesar, and then met all sorts of giants who were engaged in a struggle, a difficult, impossible struggle, some thought, to bring trade unionism to farm workers who so desperately needed it and so richly deserved it. One of those great giants was Fred Ross. But before I speak more in detail about Fred, I should tell you that our union, the ILWU, engaged in an immediate and total embrace with farm workers, not just simply because we represent all of the agricultural workers in Hawaii, but because there was a kinship over a lot of years in trying and not being successful in organizing agricultural workers in the Central Valley and elsewhere. But because these were people, they are people, that it's not tough for an ordinary, everyday human being to have camaraderie with. Our members from Bellingham to San Diego, in Hawaii, throughout Alaska and Canada, grew to hate the taste of grapes. More importantly, they couldn't stand the sight of them. And when they were delivered to the docks, the rank and file of our union, wherever they appeared, engaged in the kind of ingenious approaches to dealing with that product that only a Fred Ross could have transmitted to us, whether it was forklift trucks backing into them, whether it was the forks of those trucks tipping them over. There were some magnificent occasions where they would be loaded, you would think, from the dock, hoisted by the ship's gear up onto the ship, only to go right to the other side and get dumped in the bay. It was an effort that came natural to our people. And it was an example of how rich, rewarding, and educational it was for us to have this warm brotherhood with this magnificent organization and with Fred Ross himself. I think one of the most important things about Fred is that he was a man who had no doubt about who he was, about what his mission was. He never looked back because he felt that maybe there was something more rewarding he should have found. He was overjoyed with his life's pursuit of doing things with and on behalf of other people. Other people, however, who needed to desperately be given status, have recognition, had to understand that there was not futility to struggle, but that on the condition of good organizing, there were enormous rewards. Intimately transfer his vast knowledge and give the encouragement to engage in struggle, to be tenacious, and hear the ingenious and adroit tactics that a Fred Ross made possible. He was unusual in that he detested center stage. The spotlight was not for Fred Ross. He was not engaged in struggle for aggrandizement that would bring pleasure to Fred. He was engaged in struggle for the successes that would be registered and the joy that it would bring to people who were otherwise disenfranchised. Fred was not a man to hate, but he was a man of fierce and unrelenting commitment. And in the place of hatred, he had a determination. He had a tenacity. He had clarity on what steps had to be taken at a given time to grind that struggle to success, so that then those for whom he worked had the rewards of struggle that in life are always inevitable, not always available. Fred Ross was, by any measurement, a great man. And I used to attend meetings, rallies, forums for agitation, which come naturally to some of us. And I used to look out among that vast audience, one of those vast audiences, and I'd see Fred standing in the back, always in deep thought, always trying to calculate what the appropriate move for the struggle of the moment demanded. Never up front, never requiring attention, and then, as I said before, finding his reward in the success that came as a consequence of his ingenuity. But more than ingenuity, once he discovered that struggle was a natural part of life, that unless we engaged in struggle and didn't shirk the responsibility of struggle, Fred made sure that everyone he could talk to understood the techniques of organizing, the benefits of organizing, and while it is or might sound trite to say that, well, the world is better because we had Fred Ross, that declaration is only in the absence of trying to find one more profound that more accurately describes this man who provided enormous help, who was unrelenting in his dedication, and who gave to those of us who had the joy of a relationship with him. Something in our life that we'll never forget. And there is a legacy of his family. His son, youngest son, Fred, just turned 45 yesterday. He heads up Neighbor to Neighbor. It's an organization that has to do with organizing in the community, whether it's to bring social, economic, racial justice throughout the world in El Salvador, whether it has to do with bringing health care coverage, registering voters, Neighbor to Neighbor, is a legacy that represents his son's commitment, that is a salute to his father and an acknowledgement of his greatness. Thank you.
Inspired by her father, Julia Ross spends time helping people with alcohol, drug, and food problems. She's going to talk now about the memorial fund that we're setting up in honor of Fred Ross Sr. Julia Ross.
I want you to know how glad we are that you're all here. We've been planning this, Fred Jr. especially, of course, for weeks now, and my mother has been part of it too, and she wanted me to send her greetings to all of you who knew her. Her spirit is strong and her mind is strong, but her body hasn't been strong for a long time. I was born in Cleveland, and some of the first sounds that I heard were Kay Ueda and Ann Kunitani and Hisako. And they were some of the first people I knew, too. One of the first things that I remember seeing was the floor and my father's feet and a yellow pad in his hand, dangling. I didn't see the other hand because it was on the phone. My mother was in the other room in a hospital bed because she had polio. But my dad kept working, and people kept going in and out like they are today, and it made it fun for us all. It was really exciting. I remember playing on top of the truck that had the speakers on it where we'd go out and make announcements and play music all over town. We were outside of the Carioca, which was another place I loved. My father did have a private side, and we've been playing it for you in the music today, and we made a tape especially so you could hear some of the pieces that he loved from the time he first discovered music when he was in college. He taught us to love music too. We played records until they wore out. Paul Robeson and the Weavers. And later, of course, Joan Baez. He was one of the best readers that I've ever heard. He read aloud to us for hours. One time when he was home for 6 months, every night he'd read to us. I want you to know how glad we are that you're all here. We've been planning this, Fred Jr. especially, of course, for weeks now, and my mother has been part of it too. And she wanted me to send her greetings to all of you who knew her. Her spirit is strong and her mind is strong, but her body hasn't been strong for a long time. I was born in Cleveland, and some of the first sounds that I heard were Kay Ueda and Ann Kunitani and Hisako. And they were some of the first people I knew, too. One of the first things that I remember seeing was the floor and my father's feet and a yellow pad in his hand, dangling. I didn't see the other hand because it was on the phone. My mother was in the other room in a hospital bed because she had polio. But my dad kept working, and people kept going in and out like they are today, and it made it fun for us all. It was really exciting. I remember playing on top of the truck that had the speakers on it where we'd go out and make announcements and play music all over town. We were outside of the Carioca, which was another place I loved. My father did have a private side, and we've been playing it for you in the music tonight, today, and we made a tape especially so you could hear some of the pieces that he loved from the time he first discovered music when he was in college. He taught us to love music too. We played records until they wore out. Paul Robeson and the Weavers. And later, of course, Joan Baez. He was one of the best readers that I've ever heard. He read aloud to us for hours. One time when he was home for 6 months, every night he'd read to us. And a few Thanksgivings ago, we were trying to remember how many books he read to us. We were walking in the park, Fred and my dad and I. And we asked Rob later, and he added some, and we never got to the end of it. 13 Against the Odds, Freedom Road, The Free Musketeers. He loved poetry very much too, and when I was older, he taught me to love poetry by reading it to me aloud. As you know, he was a great actor, and of course, he was a great director. He was actually an extra in a movie in college, and it was one of the reasons that he was so thrilled to talk to Luis and with the possibility of making a movie about Cesar. And it's one of the reasons that we would like to have the memorial fund have to do with the film, so that he can be in the movies himself, finally. He also wrote poetry and prose, and we want the memorial fund to bring some of that writing to you, because it's very good. In the last 4 years, he had Alzheimer's, and he knew it was coming. We didn't believe it, but he knew it was coming. And so, over the 4 years, he began to fade. But he didn't fade away entirely until the end. And in those years when his mind didn't work and he couldn't take action, he still had the things that were private that we shared with him. He still loved music. He sang again, he danced, he watched movies on TV, he had two girlfriends, he played the tambourine, and he watched the flowers wave in the wind. He showed me where he watched the flowers wave in the wind. I'd like to read
just a little bit of a poem that was written by one of his favorite poets, whose name was John Donne, and he wrote in the 16th century in England. And I'm reading this for me and for my brothers, because we're alone now. And I'm reading this for you, and I'm reading this for him. All other things to their destruction draw. Only love hath no decay. This no tomorrow hath, no yesterday. And running runneth not from us away, but truly keeps his first, last, everlasting day. Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming.
As Jim Herman so eloquently put it, one of the great legacies to Fred is the work that Fred Ross Jr. is doing as executive director of Neighbor to Neighbor. It's been my privilege to help Fred in his work for the past few years. And like his father, Fred Jr. loves a good fight. And one thing I like is the twinkle he gets in his eye whenever there's a fight brewing. By the way, there will be a fight brewing about health care. It's coming right after the election. So, I want to introduce my really special friend, Fred Ross.
Thank you, Julie. Julie. That's what I used to call her before I could talk. Rob. Rob, who used to scare the living daylights out of me when I was a little baby, he'd tell us these ghost stories I couldn't get to sleep. I want to say a special thank you to Mimi, Silbert, and to Abe and the Delancey Street family for letting us be part of their family today. I want to introduce my sister-in-law, and the next generation of Rosses who are here with us. And I'd like to ask them to stand up so you can meet them. Kay, who's a wonderful teacher. And sister. Had the pleasure two nights ago of seeing that Ross spirit from her father and her grandfather in action on a volleyball court. She was mean and tough and aggressive and, yes, single-minded in her pursuit. Shannon Ross. My eldest niece, Heather, will be helping those of you who'd like to join in a community eulogy later this afternoon. Recent graduate of UCLA, gifted dancer, special niece, Heather. And finally, I'd like to introduce Fred's grandson, who already is exhibiting some of the same interests that I shared with my dad. I went to City Hall on Monday to meet a woman who was close to my dad and who babysat for me. Can you wait? I see you back there somewhere. Thank you. Yeah. Would you please stand again, because we didn't see you the last time, Kayueta? Thank you. I didn't even know that there was a rally going on. And the voice I heard when I came out of the parking lot was that woman in motion, Dolores Huerta. And as I walked towards the front of the stage, some big kid grabbed me, big bear hug, goes, "Uncle Gib!" And that was Brandon. He was there because of his real interest in American Indians. I guess a lot of us are losing sleep lately because of my dad. I woke up this morning singing La Cucaracha. And I wasn't sure why. And I called my mom, and she told me why. She said, "Gib, we had a nickname for you when you were about 18 months old, and it was El Borrachito de la Main. It means the little drunk of Main Street." It seems they'd had a party one night, and I'd gotten into the drinks. And in my crib, I sang my own rendition of La Cucaracha. So Mom and Dad knew how to party. I too have wonderful memories of my dad. I remember when he'd come home on a late Friday night, he'd be exhausted. Maybe he was coming from Brawley or Visalia or wherever he'd been. But when I was 5 or 6, the next morning I couldn't wait to see him. And so I'd go running into his room, and I'd jump on that bed. And Mom tried to say, "Well, at least let's get him some juice and a cup of coffee. You know, then he'd be ready to play." But he loved to play and wrestle. Some of you mentioned discipline. My brother and I, as we watched him in the hospital, we were remembering how big his hands were. And those fingers. And how hard it must have been before we had touchstone dial for those big fingers to go round and round and round. When I'd crossed the line and it was time for him to spank me, I thought up a little delaying tactic. Part of it because I was so scared about what was to come. I said, Dad, wait, I gotta go to the bathroom. That'd take a little bit of the sting out of it. One thing real early he taught us was about the worst thing a person could have was race prejudice. That was the word they used in the 50s. And I remember maybe I was 7 or 8, and my father's mother, who wasn't as sensitive as he was on the issues, was kind of surprised when her youngest grandson said, "Nana, are you prejudiced?" He made us laugh. One of the first dichos I remember was at the dinner table. I think my sister Julie had decided she didn't want the next helping. And all of a sudden, my dad goes, "Pues, entre menos burros, más elotes." Fewer the donkeys, the more corn to go around. There's one story that hasn't been told, and my mom reminded us of it. He could laugh at himself, and he was so dedicated to learning Spanish that he went to extremes. And one day while he was driving, a policeman pulled him over. And the policeman said, "What in the world were you doing? You were weaving all over the place." My dad looked up a little bit sheepishly, and he pointed at his Spanish language flashcards. He said, "I was studying my flashcards." Just as well all of you, he believed in hands-on. And unfortunately for us kids, it was the same thing with the yard work. We had a big yard, and Dad'd be out there with us. Julie was the best organizer. My brother and I used to get irritated with her because about every hour on the hour, she'd organize a friend to call. And she'd have to leave. But after the second call, though, my dad'd say, wait a second, I think something's up here. In high school, his love of literature was wonderful to share. Remember, we studied Hamlet, and we went to see Olivier's performance of Hamlet together. And he came to my English class, and the next day, my teacher came up to me and she said, oh, your father is so good at in English literature, and he's so handsome. Today she said, what a hunk, right? And that he was. I was especially lucky 28 years ago when I was 16. Because some of the books my dad had read us, Broken Arrow, about the Apaches, Cochise, Geronimo, and their example, Last of the Mohicans, made me want to get my hands on every book about Indians that I could. And when my dad came home telling us that he'd begun to organize with Lauro Garcia, who's here today from Guadalupe, Arizona, and Margie, and the Yaqui Indians in Guadalupe, I said, gee, Dad, maybe could I spend a couple of weeks with you this summer? He talked through with my mom. And my mom understood that it was time for us to start working together. I'd always been real proud of my dad. I remember one time Cesar organized a fundraising event down at CSO, and Alinsky was out for it, and I was about 9 years old. And there was a kid named David Alinsky there. And we almost got into a fight because I said, my dad's more important and tougher and better, stronger than did teach us that. We're fierce. Rosses are fierce in our loyalty and our love. And I will never forget that summer because it changed my life. Remember the first, this is when a guy named Goldwater was running for president of the United States. From the state of Arizona, Guadalupe had their first ever candidates night in history as the sun was setting in that little school. Women and men who'd never stood up in their entire lives were confronting an elected official there. A Republican supervisor came in with a white belt and white shoes. And the only reason he'd come there because they'd registered about 900 new voters. It just seemed so simple what he was doing. Registering people to vote, and all of a sudden I was helping to teach basic English so more folks could become citizens and they could be voters. And they could begin to win the victories. And what was astounding that summer was how fast the victories came. The supervisor was promising 10 miles of paved streets and stop signs and street lights, and you can have your own mailbox and you can do that. It was just like it was Santa Claus coming in, but only because those folks had gotten organized. They'd gotten organized. He loved that DiGiorgio campaign almost more than any other in his whole life, I think. Because it was a comeback for him. He'd had for himself what he considered to be a failure in Syracuse. Here was this proud man in the middle of the 60s, and unfortunately some of the children of the 60s weren't ready to take the disciplined approach to organizing that my dad had to offer. And he wasn't quite sure what to do with some of them. Except fire their ass. So he came back a disappointed man, and he came back to rejoin his best friend, Cesar Chavez. And all of a sudden, he was back to the camp where my brother was born, except this was 1966. And at 19, I got to rejoin my dad. And I spent a few weeks with him down there, and he just, you know, he didn't care how old you were. You could walk, you could talk, he put you to work, you know? All of a sudden, I was out with a Puerto Rican crew one day, and a Mexican crew, a Filipino crew, a black crew, just passing out those little mosquito zumbadores as fast as I could, and people were laughing like hell. And there was this horrible foreman by the name of Jesse Marcus. And there was a beautiful, he had everybody scared until my dad went to work on him. Not with his fists, but with his wit. And it was sharp. And by the time he got through with Jesse Marcus, every worker and every crew was laughing like hell at Jesse Marcus in front of him. That was power. In 1968, right after Cesar finished his fast, my brother drove me down to Delano. We met my dad, and we went back to Boyle Heights, where I lived my first 5 years. And within a couple hours, Tony Rios and others had gathered about 12 of the stalwarts, and they were ready to go. We didn't even have the registration materials. We got those in a hurry. They just put up a simple map that night because my dad didn't want to waste any time planning. You know, we had a few hours left to go. Real simple map, and I found, I guess I wasn't old enough to vote yet. And I was a bird dog that day. What that meant is he gave me a piece of chalk, and I'd go door to door, and I'd find out if anyone needed to register to vote. And if they did, I'd just mark an X in front, and he'd come right behind me. It was great. The next thing I knew, I was behind driving a car and speaking in English and Spanish about Bobby Kennedy and hope and power and let's go and make a difference and whatever my dad was telling me to say. He'd just write a few notes down, you know. So when I graduated from college in 1970,
bird looked like the NRA, the New Deal bird in yesteryear. Financially, we're still in the dust. I hope to get up and out gradually within the coming months. I think that we can keep our present membership. We can begin to pay ourselves $50 a week and pay for the gasoline expense. The great if, of course. Thank you very much for the contribution. Hope this is the last time we have to burden you with it. Regards to all, Caesar. May 14th, 1963. Dear Caesar, knowing how well things are going for you has both bucked me up and turned me a screaming shade of envious green. Mientras aquí va un cuero de iguana, that's a iguana skin, $20 bill. Fred. Excuse me. January 3rd. January 3rd, 1964, from Fred. Dear compañero de la pluma, dear friend of the pen, it's a good thing our pal ship doesn't depend on la pluma, or it would have long since have withered away. And I certainly can't excuse the lapse by telling you how awful busy I've been and productive. I've been, because as you know well, around these holidays shoots everything to hell in our line of work. This is January 3rd, just after the holidays. There's little likelihood I'll be down in the valley in the near future. I don't suppose you'll be coming up to San Jose, but if you do, let me know. We'll have one at the hole in the wall for the sake of auld lang syne. Warmest regards, Fred. Don't know, I used to be a little restaurant. We used to go have coffee before we went to San Jose. After hearing from Fred Jr. that Fred wasn't feeling well, David Martinez and I drove up to see him at the community where he was staying in Mill Valley. And I'm very grateful that we were able to talk to him about a week before he died. Fred Jr. warned me that his dad might not recognize us. He was sitting in a chair in the hallway. He arrived. He looked at me, and just like he did 40 years ago, his eyes opened, his arms threw his arms, and said, "Ah, Caesar!" God, we spent 3 hours with him walking around. Never did he complain about his illness. And he remembered all kinds of stuff. We walked and walked. We got tired. He invited me to sit down a couple of times, not because of him, because of me. He said, "No, I can keep on walking." We told him how grateful we were for everything he had done for us. Fred, always humble and with no trace of ego, said, "Come on, I'm not anything for you guys. You did it all yourselves." "No," I replied, "we'll never forget the lessons you taught us. Every time we take a shortcut, we get in trouble. There are no shortcuts in organizing." "Right, Fred?" "Right." We talked about organizing techniques, about preserving his work, about writing it without any embellishment, just exactly how we did it so it could be preserved. And then it was time to leave. Fred was lucid and animated, very happy. I never knew when I left that it would be the last time I'd see him. I would see him. I didn't have a chance to tell him. In addition to training us and inspiring us and being my hero for over 40 years, how good of a friend he'd become. I shall miss him very much. Thank you.
Jessica, Rob, could you guys come up and help us sing Joe Hill? Great. Fred, you want to come up now?
We invite you all to join us.
Thank you.
Hi, Rachel. It's my goddaughter over there. I'm pretty proud of. Well, we've been caucusing, and we're going to leave it up to you. My dad always liked to have democracy, so we're going to have democracy here. Would you rather get right into the community eulogy while you're all still here? Would you rather take a break, get those kidneys going, have something to eat? What's your preference? Okay, hands for a break. All those opposed? Okay, how long a break?
20 minutes.
20? My sister says 20 minutes. And wait a second, but I think there needs to be some clarification. Need some direction about the food that's been brought. That's not gonna give people time to eat. Okay. Michael, there's a question. Can people bring food back in here? Yes? I take that as a yes, a resounding yes. Okay, so let's gather here in 20 minutes, and then the family would love to hear. I'm sure all of us want to hear more stories about Fred Ross. Thank you.